He used to be a professor at Cambridge University, and I met him personally and discussed with him.
So that was in England?
In England, yes. Mm. Yes. And this man was an adamant supporter of the steady state theory.
Oh.
He said the universe is eternal. It has no beginning and will have no end. And they called it the steady state theory. And then in an interview with the BBC, he gave this term, the Big Bang, as a joke.
Actually. Making fun of people who think like that.
Yes, making fun of people, indeed.
Yeah, actually, I was going to ask you about this.
Yes.
Literally, the word Big Bang, this is the sound of a huge explosion. Is that correct?
Yes, Big Bang.
So the bang, the word bang is like the voice of the explosion.
As I said, right. This is not a scientific term.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it became a scientific
comic
term.
Yes.
This man said it as a joke.
Yes. Mm. Mm-hmm.
Actually, trying to mock the people who were talking about creation.
Yeah.
He said the Big Bang.
Mm-hmm.
And people found it a suitable term.
Most suitable.
they used it. Yeah. You see. And he did not mean that he believed in it, but later on he came to believe in it at the end of his life.
How the Big Bang came about? How it came about?
It came about, you see, matters of creation in its three dimensions, the creation of the universe, the creation of life, the creation of man. These are areas that cannot be tested by the human senses, because this is something above the human intellect. How did the universe come into being? As a Muslim, I say that this is the divine plan. Allah wanted it to be, and it was. He ordered it to be, and it was. For a secular scientist, he would say the condensation of matter and energy into a small entity would cause that entity to be in a critical position, in an unstable condition. So it had to explode, because he does not want to admit a creator to the universe.
Yeah.
He would say this was a critical state and it just exploded. But one of the leading professors of astronomy of today, he wrote in one of his wonderful books saying that we know that any explosion is a dispersion of matter and energy. But no explosion can build.
Mm.
Explosions usually destroy.
Destroys, right.
You see? Mm. An explosion cannot build. But for an explosion to build this wonderful universe, it has to be a carefully planned explosion.
And this
not
scholar
just
is Muslim?
Something that would happen randomly or out of chaos.
He's Muslim, this scholar?
No.
He's not Muslim.
He's not Muslim.
So how does he react to what he says?
Well, sometimes you see scientific activity began in the Renaissance with negating religion.
Yeah.
And that's why science has taken always the purely materialistic approach. You don't want to go into any kind of belief, any kind of morality, any kind of control over human behavior.
Yes,
they just contain themselves within matter and energy and nothing more than that. Because of this, most of the scientific conclusions in the past were anti-religion, were against belief in a creator. And even if they see the evidence obvious and clear, they will try to distort things and put it in a framework of saying nature.
Nature.
And when you ask, what's nature?
Yes.
Nobody can define nature, you see.
Mm-hmm.
So can you define nature to me? But it's a replacement. Instead of saying Allah, he says nature.
Yes.
Mm. And saying the deity or the divine being, he says nature.
Mm.
Just a way of escape. But lately, the bulky conclusions of scientific research have come to support and substantiate and establish every single belief that came in the Holy Quran or in the traditions of Muhammad, peace be upon him. So science by itself today proves that this universe cannot be the product of an accident or a chance or a chaos. It has to be a carefully planned universe. Otherwise, it would have never been the way it is today. And as I said earlier, you see, in a previous episode, these cosmic verses in the Holy Quran are actually an address to the people of our time. It's a way of talking to the people of our time in the only language they can accept, right, and the only language they can understand. And that's why unless we use them, we'll lose the battle.
Yes, I see what you're saying.
We have a battle against Islam today, and we have to convince people that their stand against Islam is a wrong stand. And the easiest way to convince them with this are these scientific notions in the glorious Quran.
Yes, inshallah. Thank you, Dr. Zaghloul. We'll go for a short break. And after the break, inshallah, we'll continue with the cosmic verses. We start with that.
Inshallah.
Okay. Thank you, dear viewers. Welcome back and continuing with Professor Al-Najjar. Dr. Zaghloul, we were talking about cosmic verses.
Yes.
What exactly does cosmic verses mean?
Cosmos is the totality of the universe.
Yes.
Everything that's being. Matter, energy, plants, animals, humans, the earth, the moon, the sun, the stars, the constellations, the wind, running water, clouds, everything. This is the universe, the cosmos.
Yes.
You see, and that's why when we say cosmic verses, means verses that relate to the creation in general.
Yes.
To everything that has been created.
Yes.
Everything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the cosmos.
Yeah. So anything that was created by Allah subhanahu
wa ta'ala? By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
naam. Okay.
And we have discussed the theory of the Big Bang theory. And we said that we as Muslims can raise this theory to the status of a law, actually, the status of an established fact. Not because experimental science has proved it to be a fact, but because there is a notion about it in the glorious Quran, where Allah says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَتَا رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا. And ratq means a condensed entity. Well, fatq means an exploded body. So ratq is the opposite of fatq.
Yeah.
It means that all this universe was in a single entity,
yes,
in the past. And Allah ordered that to be, and it went into smoke. And out of that smoke, He has ordered the earth to be created as an earth, ordered the other heavenly bodies to be created, every one with its own special mass, its own special volume, its own special physical and chemical characteristics, its own special role,
yes,
for the establishment of that universe. So no man worth his salt can ever claim that this orderly, systematic, wonderful universe is the product of an accident or a chance. But everything in that universe can clearly testify to the knowledge, wisdom, and might of the Creator, and can reflect on the greatness of that Creator, who is exalted above all His creation, without parallels, partners, or similitudes.
But Dr. Zaghloul, was that the same understanding 1400 years ago?
I cannot really impose on people 14 centuries ago to understand the scientific knowledge of today.
Yes, of
course. I cannot assume that.
Yeah.
But of course, when a Bedouin at the lifetime of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will listen to these verses, he will definitely try to understand it in a way that would appeal to his standard of knowledge, standard of culture, his understanding of the Arabic words. Definitely the Arabs at the time, moment of revelation, understood that heavens and earth were an entity.
Yeah.
And this is found in all the tafsir.
Yeah.
And this fact came to human knowledge through experimental science only in the 20th century.
Yes.
If you told anybody before the middle part of the 20th century, actually 1955.
Yes. 19, very close.
Before 1955, if you tell anybody that the earth and the heavens were one, a single entity, they would...